Today I want to show you what kind of products you can use for your watercolor painting. So I have prepared this little chemistry lab right here. Notice the dirty table? All just to set up the mood for the experiments we are going to do. The mediums we have here are quite varying. We have paste, gel, powder, spray and liquids. And depending on the medium, you can directly mix them with your watercolors or use them to prime the paper, etc. They are used to nullify or intensify existing properties or even create new ones. We are going to have a look at the liftoff medium and granulation spray or effect spray, they are quite similar, shiny stuff like the aqua shine medium and aqua bronzes, masking fluid and gloss medium, and modeling paste for watercolors and oxgel. Oh, and this video is not sponsored, by the way. Yes, I know most of these are from the same brand, but that was all that was available for me in the current situation. You know what I mean. To put these to the test, I have prepared something. This drawing here. Times four. Yes, I did the same drawing four times. And let me tell you, after the second one, it wasn't fun at all. But I wanted to be able to test and compare the mediums fairly, to avoid situations like, oh, I like that medium better because the face turned out prettier. So I hope you appreciate that kind of extra work, and maybe you can give the video a like after you watched it. I'm also going to combine two of the mediums on each of those sketches, because I think some of them are quite complementary. And honestly, I also do it just so I don't have to draw that sketch 8 times. I am not that crazy after all. Let's start with the liftoff medium and granulation spray. The liftoff medium is a liquid that adds an isolating coat to the paper. You apply it straight onto the paper to prime it before you start painting. To make sure it's spread evenly, I recommend using a flat brush. Once dry, the medium is not water soluble, so it doesn't wash off when you paint over it. Therefore, you want to avoid that this gets into your watercolors. Always clean the brush after priming the paper. When it has dried, you can start painting on top. I chose a turquoise that is usually already easy to lift off with a bit of water and a tissue to remove the wet spot. When I lifted off the primed area, it didn't take all the color with one wipe immediately, but still you can tell where the liftoff medium was applied, which is at least a sign that there is some effect. The product I want to use in combination with the liftoff medium is the granulation spray. It's supposed to mimic a granulating texture even on non-granulating colors. In case you wonder, granulation is a property of certain watercolors where the pigments agglomerate to create a rough and distinctive look. That's great for painting stones and landscapes, for portraits though, not so much. Regardless, it's always good to know what colors are granulating before you use them. And I already did a video on that, I will link it in the description. The granulation spray is used on wet paper to achieve the effect. And luckily it only affects those wet areas, so we don't need to mask anything when using it. On a side note, I have to say it has a similar effect to the effect spray that I bought years ago. There might be more differences I don't know of, but it looks and smells alike. I just thought that it's interesting. And also the effect spray can be about 3 times cheaper. Anyway, I'm not really sure what to make of this effect just yet. So let's see how it will turn out on a painting. Priming the paper with the liftoff medium, I wasn't sure whether the pencil sketch would smudge at first, but it stayed nice and clean, even after I went a bit wild with the brush. When it dried, the paper still felt and looked normal. There was no gloss or anything that could give it away that it was coated. But with the first layer of color, I definitely noticed that the paper was primed. The colors are easier to lift off indeed. And that can be helpful, for example, when you need to correct mistakes or you want to remove color. And I also feel like it gives you confidence to work with different tones. But there is a downside. Working on such a surface, it needs a lot more layering and brushwork to make the color stick. And that can become a bit frustrating very quickly. It makes the painting process take longer than normal. You basically need to rub the colors into the paper, and also it's more difficult to build up those layers because you will lift off previously dried layers when you apply more color for the shadows, for example. I believe to deal with such a change of your paper surface, it's best to adjust your approach a bit. Not painting over the lines isn't a priority anymore, because those slip-ups are easily wiped away with the tissue. But the focus now shifts to not accidentally washing away the colors. Using this medium makes it really a mix of working with it and working around it. Some areas, especially smaller details, won't really pick up colors that easily. And it's a bit like painting on paper that's waterproof in certain areas. While that sounds like a double-edged sword, in the end it really comes down to what you prefer to focus on. If you work with a few layers and like to be safe with removing colors, I can definitely see this one being of good use. If you use a lot of color washes, the ordinary absorbent paper without any coating might be better suited. Now to the granulation spray. I chose to combine it with the lift-off medium because I thought the agglomerating effect works better when the surface is primed to not be as absorbent. But that wasn't really the case here. I used it in the background and it turned out quite tame this time. The effect is pretty random though, and I wouldn't really judge it based on this painting alone. One thing that still confuses me though is that no matter how often I tried the spray off camera, it really doesn't look like granulation in my opinion. Yes, it creates an interesting effect, and in some cases, you could maybe argue that it was going for a granulating look. Just most of the time, I can't read the texture as granulation. Apart from that though, I like the fact that the application is really easy and quick. No preparations or masking, just simply spray it on the wet areas and wait for what happens. Now let's have a look at the Aqua Shine and Aqua Bronze medium. The Shine medium is a liquid that adds a pearlescent effect to watercolors. The medium has a cold white shimmer with smaller and larger particles, and it can be mixed together with watercolors or applied purely without any color. On a wet surface, those little pigments float and spread evenly, which looks really pretty in close up. And it dries down just like your regular watercolors. That means the glitter sticks to the paper but also remains water soluble after drying, so you can reactivate it again with the wet brush. The Aqua Bronze, on the other hand, is a metallic powder, in my case gold and silver. This one can be carefully sprinkled directly over the wet surface, but also it can be mixed with colors or applied with plain water, just like the Shine medium. It looks the most reflective when the surface is still wet, but also when the powder has dried, it has a beautiful metallic color. Unfortunately though, this one doesn't really set on the paper once it dried. It's pretty easy to wipe off good chunks of it with your finger. And that's why I want to combine these two mediums for the painting. I hope with mixing these two mediums we can change that. So let's see them in action. I applied the Shine medium first and spread it all over the background with a bit of water. So I don't need to pre-mix every color with that shiny stuff. Because just like with the other products, you don't really want those additives to pollute your watercolor pans. On the white background, the particles are easy to spot and you can see them leaving a grainy texture if the light is not reflected. Anyway, as I said, I chose to combine the two mediums because of the setting qualities of the Shine medium. I wanted to see whether it can also add those properties to the bronzes when combined, so I mixed the bronze together with the Shine medium and as far as I can tell, that works great together. The gold and silver colors stick more to the paper and don't lose much of their shiny appearance as they would, for example, when you use a fixative. But with metallic paints in general, usually for me it's often hard to decide if and where to use those colors. While I really like sparkling colors, in my experience they often look a bit graphic and flat, just like something was sticked on. Compared to the rest of the painting, they often lack shading and depth, and it's hard to really integrate them with the rest of the painting. But the Aqua Shine and bronzes though spread naturally on the wet surface, which I think really blends well with the watercolor look. The only thing to keep in mind is that it's hard to scan and reproduce them. The sparkling particles usually don't really look as nice on a scan. But of course, that's only relevant if you plan to reproduce a painting. Overall, these colors are easy to use and I think the effect looks great. With the right light situation, it's nice and shiny. And applying the Shine medium first and adding the colors later lets you spread out the glitter evenly without having to constantly mix them with a new color. That makes it really easy to work with tube and pen colors. I would love to see a rainbow version of this, or something with more variety. That cold white shimmer looks nice, but it doesn't take the colors you are mixing it with, so it basically always sparkles white. The gold and silver colors are great to combine with the Aqua Shine, just in case you want the bronzes to be more sturdy on the paper. So if you need something to embellish original paintings, I can definitely recommend them. But it's a given that if you want to scan and reproduce a painting, better scan the painting one time before using the shiny colors, so you can fall back on something in case the scan turns out ugly. Next up is the Aqua Gloss medium and masking fluid. The Aqua Gloss medium is a liquid that is supposed to increase the gloss and depth of the colors. And also it increases the drying time. This time though, you can directly mix it with your colors. On the paper, it can be reactivated with water, and on my first swatch, it already appears like it's only really noticeable where the color was applied thickly. But I don't want to judge it just yet and give it a try with the painting. The masking fluid is something a lot of you might already be familiar with. It's a gel that covers the paper and protects those areas from color. To apply the masking fluid, I recommend using a cheap or old brush. It's really not easy to clean the brush once you dipped it in, so you don't want to ruin any of the good brushes. Anyway, you can also apply it on already colored areas, which enables you to stack multiple layers on top of each other. To remove it, just use an eraser or your finger and rub it off. This is usually the most satisfying part about the masking fluid, but also the most anxiety inducing. If you have ever used it yourself, you will know what I'm talking about. So let's see if I'm lucky this time. The masking fluid usually is simple to use, but there are a few things to keep an eye on. I often struggle to do super small details because of the gel-like consistency. The fluid really sticks your bristles together the longer you work, so the pointy brush becomes a bit rough over time. Mistakes, like when you apply the fluid over lines, are a pain to correct, because you will need to wait for it to dry first, so you can then rub that part off carefully, just to do it again. That can make the whole thing a really time-consuming effort. Also, to come back to the anxiety I mentioned, the fluid sometimes unintentionally tears off parts of the paper when it's rubbed off. There are a bunch of different reasons why that can happen. Maybe the paper is not suited or the rubbing was too harsh. Regardless, I would avoid having it rest on the paper overnight, just my experience. If everything goes well, on the other hand, you can really put it to good use and create depth by layering lighter and darker colors or by combining hard and soft edges. It enables you to focus only on the paintable areas without worrying about the rest. It masks the covered areas well, and if it doesn't annihilate your paper, it works great and the effect looks really pretty. But also it takes a lot of time and planning. The drying times stack up. Each layer of watercolor masking fluid needs to fully dry between each application, and that can really slow down the flow of the process. Also, you have to calculate when and what exactly you need to cover for the best effect, which makes it less intuitive. The aqua gloss is mixed with your colors, and based on that, I assume it's easier to use it with tube watercolors, where you can pre-mix a good amount of paint with the medium. When I was mixing it with the colors for my pens, I needed to get a lot of color out of the pans first, before I was able to pre-mix an adequate amount. Also, I'm not really sure how much medium to mix in. For the glossy effect to be really visible, you need to apply thick coats of paint. But adding a lot of aqua gloss is thinning the paint, and therefore making it less visible. That part is a bit confusing, and I ended up dipping my brush in a puddle of the medium and just mixed it with a bit of color I could scoop out of the pans. The mixture worked like usual watercolors would though. I didn't really notice any downsides while painting with it. Just sometimes it was a bit irritating that with increased drying times and the light source I had, it was hard to tell whether the colors on paper had already dried or if it was just the medium that made them glossy. Often though, the colors were still wet and the gloss disappeared after drying. And to be honest, I was a bit disappointed because I thought it would make the whole painting glossy. But it's really only visible on those spots where I used thick layers of color. And for incorporating the medium in a painting, that creates some issues for me. Those thick glossy spots are easily reactivated when they get in contact with water again, which makes adding another wash on top a really tricky task. Thus, to make the best out of it, I would recommend to time the use of the medium a bit. For a full effect, I would say to put a thick layer of the mixture last on your painting. This way you can prevent them from getting washed away in the process of your painting otherwise. So, I wanted to combine the masking fluid and the gloss medium to see the contrast better between the matte paper and the glossy colors. And I think that was a good idea. The contrast of matte paper and glossy colors works really well together. The masking fluid didn't tear the paper, which was a big relief, and it masked the covered areas really well. The aqua gloss, on the other hand, honestly, it could be more glossy. After all, thickly applied paint has a slight gloss on its own already, so it would have been nice to see an effect on lighter washes too, when using it. Also, as I said, It's difficult to work when those layers of paint are so easily reactivated with the next layer of water. I'm not sure if I'm going to use it again, maybe for details, but nah, I don't think so. Lastly, we have a look at the aqua modeling paste and Oxgar. The aqua modeling paste is a white paste that is applied with a spatula to create relief-like structures on your paper. It can be overpainted with watercolors when it has fully dried, and when it's still wet, it can also be directly tinted with watercolors or even acrylic colors. It says on the label that it's best used on thicker paper, 300 gram minimum, and it works on cardboard and also wood. And I figured it's better to apply it rather thinly to avoid risking cracks. The Oxgar improves the flow of the colors. The medium is mixed with watercolors directly or just plain water to decrease the surface tension. And it's used to make it easier to spread the colors and let them bleed into each other. When you apply it, they basically bloom on their own. How much of use that will be for my illustration, I don't know yet. So let's find out. With the sketch on the paper, it was a bit difficult to apply the modeling paste precisely. I guess usually it's better to have the whole surface primed first with the paste, and then you would do the sketch on top. But you can scratch off excess paste when it's not fully dry, so I had some options to remove excess paste. That aside, it's really fun to apply. Like, when else can you use a spatula with your watercolor work? And once it was dry, I used a full wash of a beige tint mixed with the Oxgar. The modeling paste took the colors without any problems, just as paper. That said though, it's still not 100% like paper. I noticed little differences in behavior, like how the colors lift off or how they dry. With the Oxgar, you don't want to use too much, but I didn't really know that when I started. Because I wanted to see what it does, I used a lot of Oxgar and noticed throughout the process how the paper became absorbent like blotting paper. The colors would just bleed, and that would happen sometimes even on a dry surface. I loved that smooth, frizzy look at first. Everything appeared really soft and the colors would effortlessly blend into each other. But it became more and more frustrating each time I tried to paint hard shadows, as they tended to not stay in their place and dry with somewhat fuzzy fringes. It made it very hard to work within the lines, and that was especially noticeable with the hair and clothes. The color bleeds even underneath the masking tape, and that was really frustrating and no fun at all. All things considered though, the paste is a really fun gimmick to use, though it's a bit tricky if you plan to cover small details with it. The spatula makes applying it not as precise as a pointed brush after all. Nevertheless, it adds another layer to the painting. Maybe you want to play with more specific textures or even print something into the paste. The very fine texture enables you also to have smooth surfaces on rougher paper, which can come to an advantage for certain drawings. The Oxgar is a bit tricky. It definitely increases the flow, which makes it easier to blend and spread the colors. But that can result in the color spreading slightly uncontrollably. Admittedly, I used a bit too much, and I guess most of what I experienced is a side effect of that. Other than that, the blending looks nice and soft overall, and I can see myself using it in smaller amounts in the future. I don't think it's that suitable for detailed character drawings, but it might be helpful for landscapes or background paintings. Just those kind of paintings where you need to spread the colors on a large surface very quickly. So here we are. I painted the same picture 4 times. And while you would assume that painting was even more boring than doing the same sketch 4 times, it actually wasn't. Each medium brought its own challenge with it. Some just added glitter and some affected the painting process to a degree where sticking to my usual working methods got pretty tricky. And to me, that may be their main appeal. The effects and properties of these mediums are a fun gimmick to play around with and maybe inspire you to plan a whole painting around using them. After all, I often found myself wondering where you could put them to use the best. And while that can spark new ideas, it's also the reason why I don't really see myself using them a lot in the future. I don't think my style is something that's really suited for that stuff. The preparations, mixing, masking and blending, it all made working less quick, clean and fun, as it usually would be for me. To experiment, I did a few bird drawings. And here, where I don't have to think about staying inside the line art or even worry whether the end result will match my expectations, they actually weren't that much of an issue. I found myself enjoying those mediums much more. It's simply not black and white with these kinds of art supplies. So, would I say you need them to become a better watercolor artist? Definitely not. But for the occasion, there might be one thing or another that could be interesting to have a second look at. If you made it here, thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next one.